This is Lauren from Chvrches, and this is Records in My Life.
Hi, Lauren.
Hi, how's it going?
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, thank you.
Thank you so much for doing it today. We appreciate you fitting us into your busy schedule.
Well, I don't know if it's that busy, but thank you. I appreciate you guys having us.
Where are you cloistered these days, if I may ask?
We are in Los Angeles. We're starting rehearsals in tomorrow. And then we leave for tour at the weekend. So, yes.
Congratulations on Screen Violence. It just dropped. Well, it dropped about a couple of months ago. And can you tell us a bit about it? Do you have a favorite song on the record, or one you're most proud of?
What are my favorite ones? I feel like the opening track, Asking for a Friend, is one of my favorites. Just because I love the build of it and the release of it, and I'm quite proud of those lyrics. And I think Final Girl, so basically apparently I don't like singles. Still that guy. Still on brand. But yeah, the song called Final Girl, where it took me a long time to get those ones right, because I think at first I was like, is this metaphor, am I really running too far with this? But yeah, I feel like what most of the time when we're making albums, I don't know if you can ever say we'll definitely never make another record like this. It's always attached to the time and place. But I think when we were making Screen Violence, I felt like, lyrically especially, I was like, don't leave anything on the table, because you're probably never going to make another pseudo-concept horror album. So you might as well do it all now.
Fantastic. So you got the great end result is you got to make the record you guys wanted to make, which is the ultimate goal, I'm sure, for most artists with integrity.
Yeah, and we've always been very lucky that no matter what stage we've been at, the people that we work with have always given us that luxury. They've been like, you do you, whatever that looks like on this record. And I think going into this one, I was like, it was asking a lot of trust from people, because if you describe this in the abstract, people are like, okay. Before it existed, I'm sure that people were like, what? They made a song with like big pop producers, and now they're going to do that? That seems like a weird thing to do. So yeah, I think that we're very lucky that people were just like, okay, the proof will be in the pudding. It could be good, it could be terrible, but you do you. And yeah, I'm glad that it worked out well.
Thank you. Thank you again for being on Records in My Life. This show is about you, the artist, and the records that have inspired you. So what, going back to your youth, what were the singers that inspired you? I know your singing obviously is very important to you, and you take a lot of pride in your vocals. Can you give me a couple of the first artists that really, really inspired you to start singing?
Well, I think for me, singing was always quite a utilitarian thing. Like, it was just something that everybody did. Like, if you wanted to be in a band, you had to do it to some degree, and you had to just be passable enough that you could sing something somewhere in the background. And I wasn't really ever a lead singer until the band before Chvrches. And even then I shared vocals with somebody else, so all the pressure wasn't on me. So I think I've always just connected with things because I loved it. It wasn't even thinking, oh, how can I use this? And I remember, and maybe this is fresh in my mind because I just saw her live recently, but my dad having a copy of Jagged Little Pill, which he bought for ironic probably, and then was like, I don't know if the rest of this album's for me, and giving it to me. And I just remember hearing her voice, and not like now as a 30 something year old woman, I can definitely relate to a lot more the things she's saying than I could when I was like 15. But I just never heard anybody have a voice like that, use a voice like that. And I just, you just know immediately as soon as she starts singing on that album that it's something different. It's completely visceral. It's coming from somewhere deep and dark and hidden. And yeah, seeing her live, it's like, well, nobody really talks about, and maybe that speaks to the misogyny of media around the time of that album coming out, but I don't feel like anybody ever really talked about how amazing a singer she is. Everyone's just like, oh, her voice is a bit weird and she seems pretty angry. like that was the whole narrative around the album, right, even though it was massive. And I was watching her sing, and she's like 2 foot off the microphone, and she's singing the incredible high notes and these really difficult runs, and she's holding these long, 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 long notes. And I'm like, oh, Alanis has got diva chops, but nobody ever actually says that. So yeah, my friends I went with said that he was like, you look like a dog with your head out the window for the whole of this set. I'm just like,
that's a fantastic answer. And I think she's going to be on the same, you guys are hitting the road in the next week or in a couple of weeks, I think you're starting, because mm-hmm. I think she is going to be on the road soon too with Cat Power. I don't know, just a small footnote to the end of that story.
It was that show. It was Cat Power, Garbage, and Alanis that I saw, the triple header.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah, it was, what a night for me. It was quite an evening.
You must have enjoyed that, because Shirley Manson is I'm sure you admired her in your,
yes,
maybe a,
yes,
little bit in your youth.
Yes, 100%. And Shirley, we know a little bit through the band, and she's always been incredibly gracious and kind to us. And also, I suppose she made the point that there are a lot of odd parallels between Chvrches and Garbage. It's like producers that are slightly older than a Scottish singer who joined a band, and there's a lot, you know, they were one of the first people that were using MIDI in a live show in the, right, way that all of us use it now. So I'm like, Shirley is she's the torchbearer, so we just follow in her footsteps.
Are there any records you'd like to hear live in its entirety?
Ooh, I would love to see, and maybe I'm thinking about her because originally she was going to be on the tour with Alanis and Garbage, but I would like to see Exile in Guyville by Liz Phair, start to finish, top to bottom. I would love to see it.
Yes, wonderful record.
Oh, yeah, so good. And I read her book last year, one of the books I read during lockdown, and such an amazing, I'm like, how can one person be so good at so many things? Like, such a great writer. Like, I read a lot of books by musicians, and like, some are passable, most are not great, but I was like, wow, she's an incredible prose writer and a great visual artist and a great musician. I'm like, she can do it all, Liz, she can do it all.
Are there any modern day singers who continue to inspire, like newer, that are really inspiring you to sing these days?
I really love Japanese Breakfast, and one of the first shows I saw back after shows were allowed again was her when she played in Los Angeles. And I just think her voice, like live, I was like, she's just her pitching. And then I think a lot of people focus too much on accuracy and don't have the emotion, or too much on emotion and don't have the accuracy. And she was phenomenal, and also an amazing writer outside of music as well. I'm like, Michelle does everything. And Ellie from Wolf Alice, I think that her voice, and I love that they kind of just merged genres, like that they are not one genre. On a Wolf Alice album, there's like 4 or 5 different things that they're doing, and I love her style of lyric writing as well, that she's very honest and confessional, but then can have these big proggy, weird, spacious kind of wordscapey moments. And yes, I could never do, she does kind of like cool English girl spoken word thing, which just is not a thing for Scottish people. I'm like, no, we couldn't do that. It wouldn't work if we did it. But when she does it, I like it a lot. But if we tried, people would just be like, what? What is this?
Now, you guys are finally getting back on the road again, and you used to do a lot. I know back in the day, like pre-COVID, you hit the road quite often. What's a good record for you when you get home to sit back and relax and just, you know, unwind, whether you're vacuuming or if you vacuum, I don't know, are you
household chores?
I have been known to every so often. I have. I feel like for those things, I always go, and maybe that speaks to just audio overload when you're on tour, like music overload. I feel like I listen to a lot of like audiobooks and podcasts in that space. And I think when we're touring, it is mostly just like the comfort albums. But for this tour, I guess I made us a pre-show playlist, which I'm sure nobody else will appreciate in the same way that I appreciate it. But I was like, it's all going to be songs that are from horror films or were in the soundtrack to, or are about things that can link into this world. So it's like a 3-hour playlist that we'll play in the venues before we play. And I've got to try it once. We've played one show so far, and it was quite good because the guys in the band would be like getting ready for the gig and then be like, is that from Dawn of the Dead? I'm like, yes, yes. I think you can you can have a little quiz before you go. But in terms of like new records that I've really enjoyed, the new Sam Fender record. I like that a lot. Lucy Dacus and Bartees Strange. He's definitely one of my absolute modern day faves. Like his voice, and I've been lucky enough to know him a little bit, and I've heard a couple of new things.
Oh wow.
And if you like, I'm like, this guy, he can do it all. But yeah, like his voice on the, it generally is so cool. You can tell when you listen to it who it is immediately, which I think is the best thing you can say about any singer. But he's also got like absolute chops, and in some of the new stuff I was like, whoa, like this kid can like sing like with five eyes. So yes, when that happens, everyone will be ready. I called it, but no.
Thank you again so much for being on the show. On Records My Life, really appreciate it. I wanted to ask you, and I'm sure you've been asked this before, and forgive me, but two-part question. Do you have a favorite Cure record?
Oh, yes. Yes. Well, I mean, so many. I feel like maybe I'm basic, but Disintegration is my ultimate number one. I think Disintegration or Pornography. Maybe, but like we have always talked about, even before we had any peripheral interaction with Robert Smith, how Disintegration is pretty much it's the closest to a perfect album. In my mind, it's a perfect album, and that they were such a great example of just writing what you want when you want to write it. And if they feel like they want to write a love song, a pop song, then they do it. And if they don't, they fucking don't. And then they go years without doing it. And that all of that can exist on one album. That's the chef's kiss to me. That's the best.
How did the collaboration, how did it happen? Because you guys, I mean, you're both busy. You're both uber busy. So how did it come together?
It was just a really happy accident, really. Like our manager had been talking to some, I think it was something boring. Like we had some contract thing we needed to sign off, so he was talking to our lawyer, who also is the works with the Cure, and our manager had been like, what have you been up to, making chat, and he'd mentioned that he was working on some stuff for the Cure. And then Campbell, our manager, had asked if he could pass along his email address in case they were ever looking for a tour support, maybe we could try and pitch for one. And then he got an email from Robert Smith, because Robert doesn't have a manager, and it just said, I hear you're looking for me, what do you want? And we were like, what do we want? And then I guess, yeah, the conversation just kind of started from there. And we sent him, I think, maybe five demos from the album. And How Not to Drown is the song that he picked off of that. And he was just so incredibly generous to us, literally and creatively. And yeah, we were just worried that he would be like, I get it, you like the Cure, I can tell. Like, stop taking the piss and trying to rip me off and think I won't know this. Can't confirm, just such a great dude. Such a great dude. Could have that experience, you never know how that's gonna go. They say don't meet your heroes, but turns out I think he is one of the good ones. He genuinely is.
It's a great song. And it's a good point. Don't meet your heroes is a very good because Perfume Genius once said that too. He says he was talking about Patti Smith, I think it was, and he said, no, I have no interest in meeting her.
I don't even want to say hi to her.
Two or three more quick questions. Fun. This is our fun round, and then we'll let you go back to your day. I see you drinking a kombucha there or something, but...
Oh, it's a disgusting smoothie I made.
Okay.
I was trying to get health. This is the pre-tour enthusiasm. Right. I've got to get strong for tour, and then as I'm drinking, I'm like, bleh. Horrible.
That's so funny. Okay, weed, wine, or water to listen to your favorite record or to write?
Wine for the favorite record, water for writing, because anything I've written drunk is always terrible.
Coffee with an artist, alive or dead, any artist.
Maybe Dolly Parton, maybe. Because I feel like I have so many like stickers of like Dolly Parton quotes, and I think that hanging out with Dolly Parton must just be like that. And I think she seems like she would be up for a good laugh. So I feel like, yeah.
Record of your generation, of your high school years.
I mean, fuck, that's a rough one. That's a tough one. I think for me, in terms of what was formative for me for being in bands and writing, maybe Relationship of Command. at the drive-in, maybe. We did a lot of like playing really much faster than we should have or could have or were qualified to do in teenage bands, because we were like, we have to. If we want people to think that we're like at the drive-in, we just have to play really fast. And turns out that's not all they were doing. It was a lot more complex.
That's great. That's fantastic. Words of wisdom for your fans and our audience.
Well, I can hark it back to some of my Dolly quotes from the fridge. If you don't like the road that you're walking, start paving another one.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Best of luck. That was so enjoyable. Thank you. Oh,
thanks, Sue. Thank you for making
Thank
the time.
Thank you. Best All of right. luck. Bye-bye.
Have a good day.
You Bye. Too. Bye.
Hi, I'm Mark Henning, the other half of Records in My Life. Love it that you made it to the end of the video. Please leave us a comment, leave us a thumbs up, and subscribe. If you really dug the show, we'd love it if you'd consider supporting us over at patreon.com/RIMLTV. Cheers and see you next week.